Hi, I'm Dave Anderson. Let's talk about elasticity. The price elasticity of demand is important in contexts that might not be obvious. For example, the National Park Service is trying to raise billions of dollars of revenue to pay for maintenance. The plan is to increase the price of entering the parks by $5. Although the prices vary, let's say they raise the price from $15 to $20 per visitor. If 300 million people visit the parks each year and the demand curve for park visits looks like this, then the $5 price hike would raise $300 million times $5, which is $1.5 billion in additional revenue. But if the demand curve looks like this, the price hike will cause everyone to skip their park visit and the national park revenues will drop to zero. It's more likely that the demand curve is in between these extremes, perhaps looking something like this. And whether the price hike increases or decreases total revenue will depend on whether the price elasticity of demand is less than or greater than 1. The price elasticity of demand for a good is the ratio of the percentage change in the quantity demanded to the percentage change in the price as we move along the demand curve for the good. Since this number is always negative when the demand curve has a negative slope, we generally drop the negative sign to keep things simple. The price elasticity of demand is related to the slope of the demand curve, but it isn't simply the slope. The price elasticity formula is equivalent to 1 over the slope times price over quantity. So when the slope rises, the elasticity falls. And as we move up and down along a straight, downward sloping demand curve, the elasticity changes because the price and quantity change. Where the formula mentions the quantity, does that mean the new quantity, the old quantity, or what? The same question applies to the price. One common approach, sometimes called the point formula, is to use the old or starting quantity and price. Using that approach, going from point A to point B, the price elasticity would be calculated this way, to find an elasticity of 3/4. This approach is simple, but it does make the elasticity measure depend on the direction of movement along the demand curve. That is, going from point B to point A, the price elasticity would be calculated this way, to find an elasticity of 1/6. The difference between the elasticity measures found by going in different directions along the demand curve is smaller when the two points are closer together, so this formula is great for looking at tiny changes along the demand curve. The second approach is to calculate the quantity and price as the averages of the old and new quantities and prices. This is called the midpoint formula. The average quantity in our story is 5, and the average price is 2, so the elasticity between these points is 2/5, whichever direction you're going in. For that reason, this formula is popular for examining large changes along the demand curve. When the price elasticity of demand is less than 1, we describe the demand as inelastic. When the price elasticity is 1, the demand is unit elastic. And when the elasticity is greater than 1, the demand is elastic. A downward sloping, straight demand curve is unit elastic in the middle, elastic on the left side, and inelastic on the right side. This graph shows how the total revenue changes as the price rises and the quantity decreases. In the inelastic range of the demand curve, a price increase raises total revenue because the decrease in quantity is small relative to the increase in price. In the unit elastic range of a demand curve, a price increase has no effect on total revenue because a price increase is matched by a quantity decrease of the same proportion. And in the elastic range of a demand curve, a price increase lowers total revenue because the decrease in the quantity is large relative to the increase in price. A perfectly elastic demand curve is horizontal, meaning that a price increase will cause the quantity demanded to go to zero. An entire demand curve can be unit elastic if it is curved such that a change in price by any percentage causes the quantity to change by the same percentage. A perfectly inelastic demand curve is vertical, showing that the same quantity will be purchased at any price. The elasticity of demand differs depending on the good and the situation. Necessities such as medical care have relatively inelastic demand because if you need something, a price increase is less likely to deter you from buying it. Luxury goods such as fancy down sleeping bags have relatively elastic demand because people don't need them and can forego them if the price rises too much. Goods that take a small portion of your income, such as campsites, have relatively inelastic demand because a price change for something that inexpensive doesn't matter much to you. Goods that take a large portion of your income, such as Jeeps, have relatively elastic demand. Goods with many substitutes, such as soft drinks, have relatively elastic demand. Goods with few substitutes, such as patented pharmaceutical drugs, have relatively inelastic demand. Goods that you have plenty of time to buy, such as a hammock before your vacation in 3 months, have relatively elastic demand. Goods that must be purchased in a hurry, like a last-minute flight to your vacation destination, have relatively inelastic demand. Sellers always benefit from raising prices when the demand is inelastic because revenue will increase even though fewer units are sold. They also gain from raising prices when demand is elastic as long as the decrease in revenue is smaller than the decrease in cost that comes from selling fewer units. For buyers, it's wise to look for substitutes and try to avoid being in a rush to buy things so that sellers can't exploit your inelastic demand by charging high prices when you have few alternatives. As for the national parks, even with the $5 price hike, they're still the best vacation destination around.